Thanks for staying up later. Lorraine Bracco is with us tonight, and despite the number of films she's been in already and those upcoming, I think it's pretty fair to say that if somebody recognizes you on an airplane or in a restaurant, more than likely they're going to talk about Goodfellas, right? Is that still, to this point, the defining moment for your career?
Yes, but then there's some medicine man people that I'm always shocked about, but...
And that represents almost two extremes for you, right? Because Goodfellas was a terrific movie in which you had a terrific role, and Medicine Man was on the critical list.
Definitely on my critical list. But I think what happens is that most people really recognize me when I start to talk.
More so than just seeing you.
Yeah, they'll look at me, and a lot of people think that they know me, and I'm always asked if I'm a friend of their Aunt Nancy or something like that. Or
from Staten Island.
Did I go to school with them? No. And then, of course, you know, 5 minutes later, they come back and go, I know you. You're that girl in that movie. That's always fun.
I saw you first in Someone to Watch Over Me. A lot of people... like I said, probably first became aware of you through Goodfellas. But I remember you with Tom Berenger and Mimi Rogers and Someone to Watch Over Me. Had you done any film work before that?
I did a little bit when I lived in France. But Someone to Watch Over Me was definitely my first real making a movie, because I had gone to acting class and wanted to do it. I wanted to portray that role.
You played the wife of a New York City detective, Tom
right.
Berenger. He's assigned to protect this beautiful socialite who is a witness to a murder, and they want to protect her so she can testify. She's in some danger herself, and he not only watches over her, but falls for her. They have an affair, and you've got to fight to hold your dignity together, hold your family together.
That's right.
How did you, we were talking about it before we sat down here, so why don't you relate some of that in terms of how you gave that character some texture instead of just making her one-dimensional.
In the process of getting the role, I had to audition several times and I had to screen test several times. And in that, at one point, I guess Ridley felt the scene in the parking lot and the restaurant were too final, that my character would never take back this man in her life. And so I get the role, and this is my first movie, mm-hmm. and I'm all excited, and I got Ridley Scott, and I've got Tom Berenger, who's gorgeous. And every day you get new pages, different colored pages. Now, I'm new to this, so I don't know what's happening. And I'm reading the script, I must have read that script literally 500 times, you know, because it was that first role. Anyway, I keep seeing that I'm missing a couple of scenes. And I said, well, they just forgot them, mm-hmm. or whatever. And then I see that the numbers on the top correspond. And I say, my God, these scenes are like cut out. This is what they mean by they cut scenes out of the movie. They cut you out. And I said, well, how do I deal with this? These are like the most important roles for my whole character. This is the heart and soul of this woman. And without it, nobody's going to really care about her family or why she wants it back or how she fought for it. So I call Ridley and I say to him, look, I know this sounds kind of crazy. And I can't even say that I'm an actress saying that you're taking away scenes on me, because I've never even done anything before. So why are you taking these out of the movie? This is, I don't understand. I want them back. And I said, you know, do I have to, is this like when the actresses throw temper tantrums and cry and yell and scream? So I had sworn to myself I wouldn't do that, and I'd, you know, approach it like it was, you know, a part of my heart and soul in this movie. And I believe it was.
I'm sorry, Al. I love you. I do. And you are a lady, and I respect you very much.
Don't talk to me. Respect.
The punch is the thing that highlights the whole way in which you play.
I know,
it.
But you have to understand that it's so simple. It's like, you know, you read a poem, and what you get out of it, you get out of it, and what I get out of it, I get out of it. Now, when I read Someone to Watch Over Me, I said, oh my God, I don't remember saying, oh, I'm not going to play the victim. But I did say I would fight with everything I have to keep my family together.
The final scene is settled with your character killing the bad guy. I mean, so in the end, you emerge as the one that saves the day and, in effect, causes the final act that brings the family back together.
Well, that was never really in the original script. It was between Harley, the young, the son, and the detective who dressed up like Mimi with the fur coat on. They were really supposed to kill the bad guy. And at the last minute, Ridley said, no, you do it. And I was petrified. I don't want to kill anybody, and you know. And no, come on, you have to do it, and this is the way we're going to end the movie.
What's up, Joey? What you going to do?
Tom. Shut up.
You go to Canada, Mexico?
Shut
how you going to up with her, huh?
You go to Florida,
huh?
Shut up!
Shut up!
I was absolutely petrified in how that was going to, like, come together.
But it worked out fine.
Yeah, it did. Ridley made a good movie. Ridley's a very interesting director.
Had Martin Scorsese seen you in Someone to Watch Over Me when he cast you as Henry Hill's wife, Karen, in Goodfellas? Or was it a gut feeling or something else? What did it?
Well, that's a Marty question, but from...
Somebody call Marty.
Yes.
He'll fax us the answer, then we'll proceed.
I remember when I met Marty the first time. He hadn't seen Someone to Watch Over Me, and I had always thought that that's why I was meeting him. And I had said, you know, did you see Someone to Watch Over Me? And no. And I went, oh. And I almost wanted to say, well, why am I here then? You know, I didn't get it, but... I really don't know if he did see Someone to Watch Over Me. I don't remember.
But I guess he probably knew you because you'd been married to Harvey Keitel, and that's, you know, one of his actors and one of his associates, so you must have had personal contact.
I had met Marty through Harvey, and where I really met Marty was when he was making this movie After Hours.
Mm-hmm.
I had begged, borrowed, and steal to get in there for an audition. And I gave an audition with Griffin Dunn. And it was really quite exciting and thrilling. And I didn't get the role. But Marty did encourage me and say, keep on studying, you're a good kid. So, and that was a really big thing for me in continuing to study acting, is when Marty said that. Because I think Marty's a great director and really one of the finest that we have. So hearing encouraging words from him, he called me, I'm not going to give you the part, but, you know, you're good, kid, you're good, keep going. Okay. Cried a little and went back to class.
this is you on playing Karen Hill in Goodfellas. I had to search into the dark side of myself to create her. But remember, this is a real-life person. I mean, Ray Liotta's character, Henry Hill, a real-life guy, he rats on the mob, goes in the Federal Witness Protection Program along with his wife, Karen. So do you have less license in creating her because of that? Or?
No. I never met Karen or Henry. I read Nick Pileggi's book, and I created Karen on the basis of where she came from, her family. The relationship between her mother and father. I believe that very often You are a product of your environment, and if you have a very strong mother and a weak father, either you will recreate that life in your own life, meaning she would find someone who was weaker than her, and or she would search the tough guy. And that was very exciting. The bad boy.
Mm-hmm.
Bad boys are very exciting for women. Not necessarily the best, but very exciting. And because I believe she came from a religious home, I believe that her parents were good. I don't believe that they mistreat her in any way. And she was going to make that work, no matter what. I believe that she was going to stick that relationship and make it work in any way she could. Do you love her? Do you?
Karen, I love you. You know I love you.
No.
Karen.
No, Aaron.
Karen, please be careful. Baby, don't.
But still, I couldn't hurt him. How could I hurt him? I couldn't even bring myself to leave him. The truth was that no matter how bad I felt, I was still very attracted to him.
Was it painful in a way to do?
Yes.
Why?
Because Ray and I had to go into the dark side, you know, the drugs, the being together no matter what. You know, it was like you couldn't have any friends, you know, involved in the mob. Who are you going to talk to?
Right.
Who are you going to... My husband this and... Well, my husband killed 63 people last week. I mean, Henry was a huge drug dealer. And who is she going to talk to? Where was she going to go? I mean, how long can you live that life? It's, you know...
Yours was the only significant female character in a male-dominated... movie.
I get the boys. I don't know why I get them.
Did that present difficulties?
Well, I believe we live in a very male-oriented society, so this is just another condensed part of life. Sometimes it's hard. I mean, I think the whole movie was hard.
How much leeway did Scorsese give you? Did you make up parts of it yourself? Create lines and improvise?
Sure. Marty's great at that.
Give me an example.
Many examples. One was, I remember the line being, who do you think you are, Mr. Big Shot? And I just said to Marty, if I hear any other woman actress say Mr. Big Shot in a movie again, and I racked my brains out and came out with Frankie Valli, and Marty said, Frankie Valli? And I said, yeah, you know, I was thinking at this time and where she could be and, you know, where she would want to spend her $1.25 for those little 45 records.
Right.
And I came up with Frankie Valli. And you got the nerve standing me up. Nobody does that to me. Who the hell do you think you are, Frankie Valli?
The first time I saw you, as I said, was in Someone to Watch Over Me. And at that point, I'm not sure whether you're from New York and more or less using your own voice or whether you're just doing
totally,
an exceptionally
I'm
good
a,
acting job. And I imagine a lot of people didn't know for sure for a while.
Right, but I'm a total New Yorker. I have no desire to go anywhere.
Not even on a trip, Lorraine?
Yeah, I go on trips, but I
think you get out now and then.
I get out, but this is really my home. I love New York.
Thank you.
back with Lorraine Bracco. What happened after Goodfellas? The whole movie, so well received. Your performance was, one of many that were terrific.
Sure.
You could go up and down the line. Do you become like the flavor of the month? Do you get...
Yeah, that's the, I think, always the perfect, especially for women. I think women are very quickly the flavor of the month. Men, I believe, have a career that they can sustain a little... it's not as flighty or as... It's much more grounded for men than it has been for women.
So now the offers come in because you're hot after that.
Mm-hmm.
And the key is to make the right choices. How do you grade yourself on that?
I made movies that I felt had something to do with the politically incorrect. No, I'm teasing. I took a movie that dealt with child abuse. I took a movie that dealt with the environment. And I took a movie where I play a gay character.
Well, now, let me see if I can keep up here. Radio Flyer is
right.
The child abuse. The Environment's Medicine Man and the Brazilian Rainforest. And Switch
is the
lesbian.
I wasn't even thinking of Switch, but Switch and even Cowgirls Get the Blues. So, I've made movies that, I've told stories that I've wanted to tell. I've worked with Dick Donner, Gus Van Sant, good directors. I've been very lucky with directors.
Medicine Man, a bad experience, right? You and Sean Connery play these research scientists, you're in the Brazilian rainforest, you're trying to find a cure for cancer. The movie isn't especially good. You don't think it was any good?
For me, it was a creative endeavor that I just never fulfilled it. I never fulfilled it, and it never fulfilled me. So, it's hard.
Were they going for a kind of Bogart, Hepburn, love-hate, African queen sort of thing? Or is it just because of the muggy, swamp-like conditions that people... made that easy comparison between this and an African queen?
I think the director wanted to portray that relationship of Hepburn, Bogart, or Hepburn, Spencer Tracy. And that's all fine and good, but the fact is he had Sean Connery and Lorraine Bracco, and those are the two people he should have been dealing with, their personalities, their lives, their differences, their energies, their talent, their insecurities, and all of that. And I believe that, we didn't succeed.
On short acquaintance, and people are always different when they're really working at what defines them and when they're in other situations, so I'm in no position to know, but talking to you in the green room, you're outgoing and pretty effusive about things, but you took some real hits personally off Medicine Man. They said you were tough to work with and you were domineering, and Premier Magazine wrote a really tough article about you. Did that hurt you?
Did it hurt me personally? Yeah, I believe that when a journalist comes onto a set for an hour and... writes about what he's seen or felt in an hour is definitely not conclusive to what went on for 4.5 months in the jungle. And that's a problem with journalists. That's a problem why a lot of us don't want journalists on the set. Yes, we are human. Yes, we have bad tempers. Yes, sometimes there are reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And none of that is ever taken into what they write.
Did the fallout from that hurt you professionally?
Medicine Man made about $50 million. So if that's not successful, I don't know what to tell you.
Who's in Even Cowgirls Get the Blues with you?
It's a cast of thousands. Roseanne Arnold, Angie Dickinson, John Hurt, Rain Phoenix, River Phoenix's mm-hmm. younger sister, her debut. Uma Thurman. Buck Henry. William Burroughs. I mean, it just goes on and on and on and on.
And you play?
And I play Dolores Del Ruby.
Not to be confused.
And I have a whip, and I have all kinds of fun things. I got to play a character very far from me, a woman who lives on a ranch and who eats peyote, basically, most of her life and has these visions. And, you know, if you've ever read Tom's book, you know that it comes from the cosmos. I don't know where it belongs, but it's there, and it's spiritual, and says a lot of things, makes you think a little, simple, yet very campy and wacky.
Do you have an acting role model or inspiration?
Yeah, probably Bette.
Midler? Or?
I like Bette a lot. But
or Davis minus
Davis.
The E.
Davis. I liked her a lot.
Why?
I feel that it's hard to find your voice as a woman and not turn off, you know, men. It's a very hard, fine line. And she did it very well.
It was great to meet you.
Same
I'm
here,
a fan
Bob.
Of your work. Thanks
Thank
a lot.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Lorraine Bracco. We'll see you later.